We're going to go to the book of Mark, chapter number 6. Mark, chapter number 6. The message tonight is something that I think every Christian should... what was that? He always does that to me. The message tonight is something that I think we all need as Christians... because the Christian life is very busy. There's a lot of work involved. And it's definitely not for the faint of heart. It's definitely easy to live out in the world and do things in the world. And the Bible does say the way of the transgressor is hard. But the Bible does not say that the way of the Christian is easy. Jesus said that, you know, we would have some hard times and we would be going through some things. But this message tonight, you know, it's my prayer that it would be encouraging to all of you. If you have your Bibles, we're in Mark chapter number 6, and we're going to start reading in verse number 7. And what's going on here is the disciples are in it. They are basically right in the middle of their ministry. They are probably the busiest that they've ever been. And what I want to do tonight is I want to make a parallel of what the disciples are going through with what we do here at the church. And you're going to see that, how do we know that this is a Bible church? Because what we do is very close, if not identical, to what gets done in the Bible. And so in Mark chapter number 6, the Bible says this, "And he called unto him the 12, and began to send them forth by two and two, and gave them power over unclean spirits, and commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey save a staff only, no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse, but be shod with sandals, and not put on the two coats. And he said unto them, In what place soever ye enter into an house, there abide till ye depart from that place. And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear you, when ye depart, then shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in that day of judgment than for that city." And they went out. The disciples are doing it. God gave them a commandment to go out two by two. And verse 12 says, "And they went out and preached that men should repent. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them." Let's jump over to verse 30. After they start going out and they start preaching the word of God and they start healing the sick, the chapter breaks into a separate story with Herod and what he did with John the Baptist and how John the Baptist met his end. And then the story kind of comes back in verse number 30. And the Bible says in verse 30, "And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught." So the disciples are having a testimony service right now. They're saying, "Jesus, man, you would not believe what we did today, man. We've been going out. We went two by two. We've been preaching. We've been healing the sick. We've been healing all manner of diseases, man. You and your name upon us and the power that you've given us. Man, we have seen so much done for God. Jesus, it's amazing." And Jesus says unto them in verse 31, "Come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest for a while." Wouldn't it be nice if in ministry we had time to rest? Jesus says, "You've done good work. Now let's go away and rest for a little bit. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat." They were so busy serving, they didn't have time to eat. Isn't that like super church sometimes when, man, we get, you know, right from the service, we may be able to run upstairs, maybe grab a bite to eat, and we're back out on the buses ready to serve. "And they departed into a desert place by ship privately. And the people saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran afoot thither out of all the cities, and outwent them, and came together unto him." That's amazing right there. Because what's happening is Jesus says, "Guys, let's get in the boat. We're going to get in the boat, and we're going to go to a desert place." And then the people that they were they were ministering to, they see them getting into the boat and they see them leaving. And the Bible says that they knew who they were. They knew it was the disciples. They knew Jesus was on the boat. And the Bible says these people ran afoot out of all the cities and outwent them and came together unto them. So what they're saying is the people ran so fast to catch up with Jesus that they didn't go in the water. They ran through the land around that body of water to where they could meet Jesus on the other side. That's some dedication. You know what that reminded me of? That reminded me of when we're driving the bus and the kids are running after the bus. Pick me up, I want to ride the bus. It's amazing. And then verse 34, the Bible says, and Jesus, when he came out, saw much people. So he gets out of the boat, and he's thinking, we were supposed to go to this desert place. We're supposed to be alone. And as soon as he steps out, he sees these people. Where do all these people come from? Now, he's the Lord. He knows what's going on. But just imagine if it was just us. Man, we thought we left all these people back there, and now I'm coming out of the boat, and I see all these people. And the Bible says he was moved with compassion toward them because they were a sheep not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. Isn't that true of our young people? They have no leadership. And I can't tell you how many times, and I wish it would happen more often when I see these kids, and man, my heart just breaks for them. Especially sometimes when I get to see, when I'm visiting, I get to see their houses and just what's inside, maybe just get a quick peek, and I'm like, man, I just pray for them. But Jesus said he had compassion. He said the first thing he said he wanted to do was teach them. That's the best way to help our young people and in ministries. If we really have compassion for these people, we need to be teaching them. And then verse 35, and when the day was now far spent, so this is all happening in the space of a day. This is all happening at the same time. The boat ride, meeting the people running around, catching up to Jesus. The day was far spent. His disciples came unto him and said this, this is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away that they may go into the country round about it, into the villages, and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. How many guys, when by the time Super Church is close to being over, you're like, man, can these kids just go home? They get tired. I know I get tired. And he answered and said unto them, give ye them to eat. And they said unto him, shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? The disciples were already complaining about the cost to minister to the people. I'm glad that we have a church that gives. I don't think we complain about the cost because I know, because every Sunday when we do the Super Church, the table is full of stuff. And so thank you for the people that do that. I'll read a couple more verses and then we'll be seated. We'll have a special. Verse 38, he said unto them, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, they say, 5 and 2 fishes. And he commanded them to make all sit down by companies upon the green grass. And they sat down in ranks by hundreds and by fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up to heaven and blessed and brake the loaves. And he gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fishes divided he among them all. And they did all eat and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments and of the fishes. Let's pray. Lord, I just want to thank you for this day, Father. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you've done. Lord, thank you for the great spirit that's been in the church house this evening. Father, I pray for our teenagers. Lord, I pray that you begin to speak to them as their service is getting ready to begin. Lord, I pray for Ms. Kara. I pray that you give her strength while she's out there. I pray that the teens and the counselors would make great decisions for God this week. And God, I pray that you'd speak to us today. Lord, I pray that you would do that. Lord, thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Say to hopeless. who can remember their way home, and everything is out of their control.
Message. And so thank you, ladies, for that. That was awesome. We're still not done in this story, but I wanted to pause it there because I wanted to kind of break it up a little bit and just help you guys to understand what exactly is going on. Jesus gives his disciples the power to go out into the world. He gives them the commandment to go two by two, knock on doors, reach people, get them to trust the Lord, heal the sick, do whatever you have to do to get people to Christ. And they take that commandment and they run with it. They get excited about it, man. They go out and they start reaching people. And the Bible tells us that them, and there were so many people. The Bible says, and they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. And then they get so excited. They go back to Jesus and say, Jesus, you would not believe what has happened since you gave us the commandment, since you gave us the power to go out and to reach the world. And they begin to testify. And so they're excited. Think tonight, when was the last time you were excited
about fulfilling the commandment of God for your life. When was the last time? And when I mean excited, I'm not just talking about, you know, yeah, man, we get to go to church. I love church. I mean, you were genuinely excited. Like, man, whoo, man, Super Church is going to be awesome today. I'm excited, man. When I came in today to church, man, I was excited because of this passage, because I was thinking maybe I was losing it. Maybe I wasn't having the excitement and the enthusiasm that God wanted me to have. And I'm going to tell you exactly what was going on, that they were getting tired. They were getting tired. They were serving. They were working a lot. And then when Jesus kind of gives them a little bit of hope and says, all right, guys, you guys have done a good job. You guys have done work. Let's go and rest for a little bit. They think, all right, yeah, good. We're going to go rest. Well, by the time they get to the other side, the people are still there. They still want to hear from Jesus. They still want to be taught. And so the disciples in their minds are probably thinking, man, I thought we just took care of all these people. Why are they still here? So then they go and say, Jesus, please, could you just send them away? God, we love the people, and you know, we know you love them, and we know you want to take care of them, but can we have our time? Can we have our own time, our private time? And Jesus quickly says, give them something to eat. Basically, Jesus wanted the people to be as close to him as possible all of the time. But the disciples, they weren't too excited about it. They were starting to lose that enthusiasm. And then Jesus says, let's do something about that. He says, give them something to eat. And then the disciples start complaining. Are we going to spend the money that we have and give them bread? 200 penny worth of bread. That's not 200 pennies or $2. Penny worth, that was like almost a day's wage for these people back then. So it was not cheap to feed these people, because the Bible says in verse 42, and they did all eat and were filled. If you guys just think about a Fellowship Sunday, what does it take to feed just us and to fill us? All right? Being Baptist, it takes a lot to fill us. And we believe Jesus was a Baptist, and everyone that believes in Jesus was a Baptist. And so it took a lot to fill these people. And then after they filled everybody up, in verse 43, the Bible says, and they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments and of the fishes, and they did eat of the loaves, and were about 5,000 men. It just says 5,000 men. Doesn't say anything about women or children. And so, I mean, back then, every man wanted to have a wife. And you know, if you could imagine, there was a lot of people here. Then verse 45, the Bible says, and straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and go to the other side before unto Bethsaida while he sent away the people. He says, guys, we fed the 5,000. Now get back on the boat and leave again. But this time, Jesus is staying behind. The first time, he got in the boat with them and they went. This time, Jesus says, guys, I've done the work. I fed them. You guys get back on the boat and you guys go away. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. Jesus thought that the most important thing that he should do after he ministered to the people was pray. And he did that alone. Let me give you some encouragement. If you feel as though you lost your excitement, you've lost your joy for service, get alone and pray. That's the best way that God can give you that fire back. But let's continue with the story. In verse number 47, the Bible says, and when even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. So even, this is the dark. This is in their time. This is like midnight, our time. It's right there in the beginning. So remember, this is all happening on the same day. So they've gone, they've testify to the Lord what's going on. They got on a boat. They tried to go over the land, but the people caught up to them. So then they had to spend the rest of the day feeding 5,000 people, just the men, which was probably more than that. And so then they get on a boat, and now it's the middle of the night. The boat is in the middle of the water. Jesus is on the land. And he, talking about Jesus, saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. More work. They're on this boat. They're toiling and rowing. They're like this, ugh, trying to, you know, they didn't have, you know, motors back then. right? So they're, you know, they had to row, and the wind was contrary. So where they wanted to go, the wind was going against them, so the wind wasn't helping. So it was just increasing the amount of work, the amount of stress, the amount of pain that these men were in, because they witnessed the people, they got on a ship, you know, and we know if you've ever been on a boat, traveling by sea is not always the greatest thing, especially if you don't have the luxury. So they didn't have that back then. And so they had to go through that. Then they get out. They thought everything was going to be good. But then they immediately go into another form of service. They have to go and feed 5,000 men. And, you know, men, how much food does it take to fill us, right? If it's just the men here to fill our bellies, it would take a lot of work. Five loaves and two fish wouldn't have been enough. So Jesus had to perform a miracle just for the men. But for the ladies, because we know ladies eat two times more than men, but don't gain the weight, thank God, we know that there was a lot more people that had to be fed then. So what I'm saying is that the disciples had a lot of work to do, and they get back on the boat. And then while they're on the boat, they're rowing, going to Bethsaida, which is where the Lord told them to go. And while they're going there, the wind decides to go against them. And now they're having to work even harder. And it's the middle of the night, working all day, serving the Lord, doing what Jesus wanted them to do. They weren't doing anything wrong, you know. But through the process, you begin to see that, you know, they were getting a little bit upset. Jesus, could you send them away? God, we're tired. Could you send them away? Should we spend all of our money, 200 penny worth of bread, to feed these people? You can see that they're getting tired. And then in the middle of the night, now they're toiling and rowing in this boat. And then it says, and about the fourth watch of the night, this is the fourth watch would be between 3 and 6 a.m. So, you know, their day has not stopped. They've gone all day, and now basically they're going all night in this boat. On the fourth watch of the night, in verse 48, he cometh unto them walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. But when they saw him, the disciples saw the Lord walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out, "What is that? Oh my goodness! What's that there in the water?" They had no idea what was going on. For they all saw him and were troubled, and immediately he talked with them and saith unto them, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid." Can you imagine? I know why they probably couldn't tell if it was Jesus, because they were so tired. They had gone all day, did all this work. Now they're rowing at night. And you can imagine their eyes are just like, oh, man, just getting tired and falling asleep. And then out of nowhere, they see this person just walking on the water. And they said, "What is that?" And they think it's a spirit. And we know how the men back then were. Every time they saw a spirit, they either got scared or frightened, or they passed out. And it's like, man, it's like these guys just couldn't take a spirit showing up. I mean, but honestly, if a spirit showed up today, we probably all of us would pass out, right? But that's what happened. They see us another spirit, and but then Jesus says, "Guys, it's me. Be of good cheer. Don't be afraid." And he went up unto them into the ship. And the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wonder. So now this spirit gets onto the ship. They still doesn't verify that they knew that it was Jesus there. This spirit gets onto the ship, and then the wind stops. The wind that was going against them while they were rowing, it just stopped. So now it's just going to make it easier for them to be able to roll. But when that spirit gets on the ship, we know the spirit is the Lord. It says they were amazed in themselves. They were thinking, man, what is this? What is going on? Beyond measure and wondered. How could this happen? How could somebody walk on the sea, come up to the boat, get on the boat, and as soon as they step on the boat, the wind stops. The sea is calm, and we can start rowing and getting to where we need to go a lot easier. This is why they had that thought. Verse 52, this is where I wanted to get to. For they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. So by the time all this happens and Jesus performs this amazing miracle, it's a miracle. How many of you guys have ever walked on water? How many of you guys have ever been out in a thunderstorm and just said, "Storm, peace, be still," and the storm just stopped? How many of you guys ever tried that? I've tried that plenty of times. Yeah, Brother Mike, Miss Mary, "Storm, be still," I must not be right with God. But Jesus does this. Listen, Jesus does this, and the job gets done. And so these men are like, how did this happen? They're so amazed. And the reason they're thinking about this in themselves is because they forgot that earlier in the day, the same day, think about this, the same day, they forgot about the miracle that Jesus had already performed when he fed 5,000 just men, not including women and children. That was a miracle in of itself. And they forgot to think, wait a minute. We left Jesus out on the land. This has to be the Lord. They forgot about that. They were just going about, you know, doing what they had to do, rowing, getting to where Jesus told them to go. And they were so exhausted. They were so tired. And by this time, after they had done all this work, the Bible says their hearts were hardened. People, church, if you're here today and your heart is hardened because of the service you're doing for the Lord, we have an answer for that. In verse 52, the Bible says this, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves. If you want to be able to go and serve the Lord, like I said, we were trying to liken it to working here at this church and working in this ministry and in the super church. I mean, can you imagine, you know, we're getting ready to feed a lot of kids, a bunch of hot dogs on Saturday. You know, we're not going to feed 5,000 men, but there's some parallel there. And then, you know, we're going to, you know, it's a Saturday. How many guys, Saturdays, that's usually your day of rest. That's usually, Lisa's like, not for here. And now this Saturday, you know, we're going to be using a good part of the day for Super Church. So we're going to be serving again. But this message is kind of preventative for myself, because I never want to get to the point where when I start serving the Lord, or when I get up to begin my day to serve the Lord, that it becomes a grudge to me, that my heart is just hardened. It's like, man, do I really have to get up? Do I really have to go soul winning? And I think a lot of us fall into that trap, especially on Wednesday nights when it's time to go soul winning. We get up and say, oh, it's Wednesday? Oh, man, I don't really want to go. Your heart's hardened. If you're not showing up to go soul winning, your heart has been hardened. And not that I'm anything great, but, man, soul winning yesterday was awesome. Man, we went out, the group we went out with, I went out with Brother Frank and Miss Lynn and Miss Kim, and we knocked a couple doors, and then Frank got to lead a 14-year-old to the Lord, and then we kept going, then we met up with another group of people, and then as we started knocking, I went and knocked on this lady's door. Her name was Evelyn, and she basically only spoke Spanish, and so I started witnessing to her in Spanish, and I led her to the Lord in Spanish. And that was the first time I had ever led someone to the Lord in all Spanish. When I was a teenager, we had taken a mission trip to Mexico, and the youth pastor used me as a translator, but that wasn't me really doing the work. I was just translating. But this time, at this day, man, I was able to lead this lady to the Lord in Spanish. And as soon as I did that, man, it kind of put that excitement back into me, because it kind of felt like the first time I led somebody to the Lord. Do you remember the first time you led somebody to the Lord? Have you ever led someone to the Lord? The problem that the disciples had was that they were doing so much work, but the problem was that when something else came up, they forgot to think about the miracles that happened. Church, serving the Lord is a miracle. And I want to help you tonight. The title of the message tonight is called Consider the Miracles. In verse 52, the Bible says, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. They did all this work. They did all this pain, all this toiling, and they were doing it for a good reason, because the Lord told them to. And so they were doing what God told them to do. They were serving the Lord faithfully. These weren't men that were just being lazy and just saying, all right, I'll get up and do work. No, they were out. They were witnessing. They were healing people. You know, it takes a lot of work to do that kind of stuff. And then they get on boats and they're sailing, and then they got to feed 5,000 men. And then they get back on a boat. Now they're rowing all night, all the way up into the morning. And then someone comes up on their boat. I mean, just a lot going on. And with all that service for the Lord, it was easy for these men to get their heart hardened. And one thing I thought about was the entire time that they were serving the Lord, Jesus was with them the whole time. So it's absolutely possible for your heart to get hardened serving the Lord. Doesn't mean that Jesus hasn't left you. It just means that your heart's been hardened. You've gotten exhausted or you've gotten tired. And if you feel that way today, God wants to help you with that. And so we want to talk about today, we're going to go back through this passage that we've been reading tonight, and we want to talk about this considering the miracles. The first miracle we want to talk about is in verse number 7, the miracle of the calling, the miracle of the calling. In verse number 7, the Bible says this, "And he called unto him the 12 and began to send them forth two by two and gave them power over unclean spirits." The miracle of the calling. You see right here, Jesus called these men. He gave them a calling. He gave them a job to do. And he gave them two by two. And not only did he did that, he gave them power, physical power to do the job that God has called them to do. Guys, can you think about it? What God has called us to do here in Philadelphia, it's a miracle. And he's called us to do this here. It's a miracle that God would call a man from Arkansas, an old drug addict, and bring him here to Philadelphia to start a church and start a great work for the Lord. And then he gets to have a nationwide ministry reaching other people. And as he does that, they support him so he can build another church and so that this city can continue to be reached in full. That's a miracle. And all of that started because of a calling. Think about the young kids that we get to work with. It's a miracle that I always think it's a miracle that the parents let their kids ride on the bus with us. I mean, if it was me, I'd be like, no, my kids, I don't know you. I've never met you. But these parents, and God softens their hearts to do that. And praise the Lord that God softened my mom's heart and she let me ride the bus. And it's worked that way for over 35 years, as long as the bus ministry has been around. But it's a miracle that that gets to happen. And it's a miracle that God has called us to do a work here in Philadelphia to reach the city. And it all starts with a calling. If we want to get back to the area, to the time in your life when you're no longer having your heart hardened and you're no longer frustrated with serving the Lord, go back to the time when you remember the time when God called you to do something. When you first began your ministry, when you first began to serve the Lord, when you first took a little child by the hand and you prayed with them, or you first took a little child and you sat with them and you went through with the Bible and you led that child to the Lord, or that first time you took a selfie with a kid because they were so excited about what was going on in the program, or when you were sitting there with a child in your row and you're just going excited, going crazy and singing a song. Go back to that time when God called you to do that, because it's a miracle that God did that for you. And the problem with the disciples was they forgot about the miracles that had happened just earlier in the day. And so it tells us that it can happen immediately. It can happen over time, but here it happened immediately for them. It happened the same day. And they have to get back to that time where they remember the miracle of the calling. Next, we see here in verse number 13, we see the miracle of capability. The verse right here in verse 13, the Bible says, "And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them." We see God has given these men the capability to be able to go out and to do the job that God has called them to do. You see, if your heart is hardened, maybe it's because you're thinking that you have to do all the work by yourself. But can I tell you, you're not doing the work by yourself. The Lord is there. The Lord has said that here, if you need me, I will give you the strength. The Bible says that our strength comes from the Lord. And the reason these men, their hearts started to get hardened was because they said, "God, we did all this work already." They were thinking about themselves. "God, are we going to spend all our money and buy these people food?" They were thinking about themselves. They weren't thinking about the power and the capability that Jesus had given them to do the work that Jesus has called them to do. And so if you are hardened today, remember that it's not you, it's not me, it's the Lord that has given us the power and the strength and the ability to do the work. Because if you think it's all about you, you are going to pass out. You are going to get tired. You're going to feel as though, man, I cannot do this. I'm tired. These kids are getting on my nerves and they don't want to respect. They don't want to obey. It's because you're just thinking about yourself. Oh, man, we got to buy hot dogs. Oh, man, we got to buy candy. Oh, we got to buy sodas. Oh, we got to buy this stuff on the bus now. Like, well, you're thinking about yourself. Yeah. Instead of thinking, man, God gave me a job. God gave me extra money this week. I get to go and give money to these kids, and God's going to do something great. And see, there's a miracle there in the capability, because I don't have the money to do the stuff that I do every week. And I know that you guys don't have the money to do the things that you do every week for our young people. And so the only logical conclusion to that is that God has given our church the capability to serve the Lord, to reach this city for Christ. And so we need to remember that, guys, it's a miracle that we get to serve the Lord, because it's not what we can do. It's what he's done through us. Then we see the miracle of calling. We see the miracle of capability. In verse number 30, we see the miracle of the communication. The miracle of the communication. Look at verse in chapter 6 and verse number 30. The Bible says here, "And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught." It's a miracle that we have a church where we get to come together and we get to encourage each other and talk to each other and communicate with each other and testify to each other about what God has done. Think about it. What has been some of the most sweetest services we've ever had at Liberty? Has been the testimony services. Has been those times when we would just get up and say, "I just want to thank God that I got to lead a little boy to the Lord. And I just want to thank God that I got to witness to a lady in Spanish this past week and she was able to get saved. Man, I just want to thank God for what God has been doing in my life. I want to thank God." What are we doing when we do that? We're testifying. We're talking to each other. We're talking to the Lord. We're saying, "God, thank you so much for what you've done." We're communicating with each other. We have a place where we get to gather together, where we get to encourage each other and communicate. And that's what the apostles did. They gathered together. That's why church, people, is so important. You know, people say, "Well, I love the Lord. I'm a good Christian. I don't have to go to church." No, we need to be in church, because the gathering of the apostles is the time where we get encouragement. It's the time where we get instruction, so that way we can get our tanks filled back up, so we can remember the miracles that God has did, and we can talk about the miracles that God has used us to be able to do, so that way when we're done here, we can go back out there, get back on those buses, find more kids, fill up those buses, bring them back here, and reach the city. And so there's a miracle there in communication. Because if it wasn't for this church, I would never have met Lisa. I would never have met Miss Linda. I would have never met Miss Mary. I would never have met any of you. I don't believe that hardly any of us would have met any of us had it not been for a place where we can come and communicate. And so I believe every church that is ever born is a miracle. And part of that miracle is the fact that we get to communicate with each other. If your heart is hardened, it's probably because you've been worrying about yourself, thinking about your own thing. And you know what happens when you do that? You don't want to talk to anybody. You just want to be alone and kind of wallow in your own sorrow and your own grief. When the best thing for us to do is to get it out there and to talk to each other and to communicate with each other our griefs and burdens. And that's why the Bible tells us that we should be bearing each other's burdens, because when we do that and when we communicate with each other, that miracle that the Lord has for us can come forth, and then it gives us that encouragement that we need to be able to continue to doing the work of the Lord. Because if we just keep doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it on our own, we are not going to succeed. We have to do it together. We have to have a place where we can communicate. And that is a miracle in of itself. The fact that we get to be in Liberty, it's a miracle. And you know what I'm excited about? There's another miracle coming. It's called Bible Baptist. It's right down the road. people have been coming. It's a miracle that men from all over the country have decided to drive up here for free, do all this work for free, get a church started for free. Why? To reach the Lord. That's a miracle. And we need to remember that. There's a miracle being born in our presence, people. And we need to make sure that we call it for what it is. It's a miracle. And once we realize that these are miracles that are happening, man, it's going to make serving the Lord so much easier. So we see here the miracle of the calling. We see the miracle of capability. Man, God has given us everything that we need to get the job done. God has provided us with buses. He's provided us with finances. He provides us with the fuel for those buses. He provides us with promotions, a beautiful facility. How many churches you go to in this area and they look as nice as this place does? Brother Horton, he was my Bible college professor when I was in Bible college. He came and he preached for us one time. And I don't know if you guys remember this, but the first thing he said was he gave our church a compliment. He says, "Your church is clean." That's a compliment, because a lot of churches, they just let things go. They let things fall apart and do that. And thank God we have a pastor that is so hard on us to make sure that we do everything first class, so that we keep this building the way it is, because he sees the miracle here. And he sees the capability that God has given us. And then we get to come to this place that God has given us, this amazing building, and we get to communicate with each other. Next, in verse 34, we see the miracle of compassion. And so when Jesus gets on the boat with his disciples and they start sailing away thinking they're going to be alone, they're going to go to a desert place alone, the people say, "Oh, there's Jesus, there's him." They had groupies. They had these people that were just running after them, and they ran as fast as they could, and they went faster than that boat, and they met Jesus on the other side. And then verse 34, "And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them, because they were as sheep not having a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things." There's a miracle of compassion. I don't know these kids. They don't know me. It was an absolute miracle when Kara knocked on my door in Camden. It was an absolute miracle. And then when I started going to the church and I started getting affiliated with them and getting to know the Lord better, it was awesome. God was doing great things. And then through different circumstances, the church had to close, but Brother Cordell had compassion on me. He said, "No, we can't lose him." And so they began to invest. If you have a hard heart today, when was the last time you had compassion for somebody? Think about the person that had compassion on you when they talked to you, when they knocked on your door, when they witnessed to you. Because if that person was that day had their heart hardened, you probably wouldn't be here today. They may have gotten up and done it just for duty's sake, but man, it's a miracle that they got up. It's a miracle that my door was knocked. It's a miracle that a bus came and got me. It's a miracle that someone invested in me, and it's a miracle that someone has invested in you. Well, you say, "Well, Brother Jared, I'm doing all right. I mean, I have a good job. I have a good family." But how are you doing spiritually? And our pastor, he's invested into our church so much. Not just his own time and his money, but his prayers and his toilings. There's no way. He tells us all the time. I mean, there's some times when somebody here is going through something and he doesn't tell me anything. There's some things he keeps from Brother Paul and Miss Kara that goes on in this church, and he has that compassion for you. He prays for you. And so there is a miracle there. Thank God that someone had compassion on you. That's a miracle. And if your heart is hardened today, consider the miracle that, man, somebody thought about me so much that they were willing to get up out of their seat, go soul winning, knock on my door, witness to me, and gave me the Bible so that I could get saved. Thank God that somebody invested in me, is staying on me, even though I may have left the church, I'm coming back to the church. Even may I wasn't as spiritual as I used to be, now I'm coming back and I'm doing the right thing. Why? Because someone had enough compassion on me to teach me. And that's what Jesus did. It says Jesus had compassion toward them, and then he says he begins to teach them. The best way to show compassion for someone is to teach them. Who are you teaching? Who have you taken the time to go to them and say, listen, let's work together. Let's get to know God a little bit better together. That's a miracle. Thank God someone had compassion on me. So we see here that in just this passage, there's so many miracles happening. We see the miracle of the calling. We see the miracle of capability. We see the miracle of communication. We see the miracle of compassion. In verse 43, we see the miracle of capacity. Go to verse number 43. This is right after they had fed all the men. All right? Verse 43, the Bible says, and they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments and the fishes. So they turned 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes into 12 baskets full of the fragments and of the fishes. You know what I call that? That's called profit. Because if you were to take 5 loaves and 2 fish and sell it in the market, you know, maybe at today's price, maybe you'll get $10. But if you take 12 baskets full of bread and fishes and sell that, it's a lot of profit. That's a lot of money. And I'm not talking about money in particular, but what I'm going to liken that to, that there's a miracle of capacity there, is that the amount of work that we put out, God gives us capacity. He gives us profit in the work that we do. We may be investing in a little boy today, but that little boy will grow up one day, and that little boy could lead thousands, millions to the Lord. I'm just a young man. I still see myself as that little boy that grew up in Camden, New Jersey. But now God has used me and has given me a platform to reach young kids all over the country from just one person. We get to reach close to 120 kids on a great day at Super Church. And I already have plans in my mind, and I'm going to be talking to Pastor about this, about the next level. And I'm telling you guys, when I come up with this idea, you're going to see it's going to be big. Because I'm thinking profit now. I'm thinking, man, we need to take what we have and just explode it exponentially. God has given us that capacity. He's given us the ability to gather together, to hold on to everything that He's, all the miracles that He's given us is all for this, to reach the city. There's a lot of people here, 6 million plus people here. How are we going to reach them all? We're going to need capacity. We're going to need buildings. We're going to need fellowship halls. We're going to need new churches. How is that happening? Because God's given us the capacity to do it. It's a miracle. And how did it all start? Brother Frank, how did it all start? How did the church start? Just a couple families? Yeah. I mean, it's amazing. It all started small, and look where it is now. There's capacity. There is a miracle, people. If your heart's hardened, you better think about that. Think about how the church just started. We started so small, and now the profit has just been growing. The amount of people coming in, the people getting saved, the people that have been coming and joining the church just this past year. You know, just this past year, we profited with Kelsey, and we profited with Brother Mike coming in, and we profited with 2 new babies coming in. And so we see that God's already beginning to grow the church, and that's just small examples. God took 5 loaves and 2 fish and turned them into feeding 5,000 just men, and we don't know how many women and children there were. And then after all of that, there was still profit left over. So think about that. No matter how much work you put in, no matter the hours, the time, the toiling, there's going to be profit in the end. And there's always profit in serving the Lord. And that profit there is a miracle. And that's what God wants us to strive for. And so I have one more for you. We've seen the miracle of calling. Thank God He called us, the capability. He gives us the power to do it. Communication, we have a place where we get to come together and encourage each other. Compassion, where we get to give our hearts and our lives for these young people. Capacity, that we see that there's profit in serving the Lord. That it's not all for nothing. That it's not all in vain. It's all for something. God is doing a work here. If your heart is hardened, the only thing I could tell you is verse 52. We'll see the miracle of consideration. Verse 52, all this happened And then Jesus does this amazing miracle. They start wondering, how did this happen? And it says, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. If your heart is hardened, you need to take the time today and consider, think about, ponder, pray. Man, God, what have you been doing? What have you been doing in my life? A lot of people in the church this year have been stretched to do things that they've never done before. I think one of the biggest examples would be Miss Amanda and the skit that she's been doing, being the prayer guardian. I mean, when I first told her she was going to do, she's like, Brother Jared, no, I'm not doing that. No, there's no way, there's no way, there's no way. But now now she comes up and she's encouraging young people to pray for some of the hardest situations that they go through on their level. Consider that. When God begins to do miracles, don't wonder. Why are we, wow, the church was full this week. Wow, how did that happen? It's because we put the work in. It's because God blessed. It's because there's a miracle there. Man, the bus was full this week. Why? Because of the work that we put in. Because of the miracle that's involved with that. We need to remember another reason why our heart gets hardened is because we get so focused, and I'm talking about myself, we get so focused on ourselves and the hard work that we're doing that we just don't consider what he's already done. And if we take the time and consider that, it's a miracle that we get to go back into our minds and remember things. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, I can remember things when I was a child. I'll never forget the day that I got saved. Thank God I can always consider that. I'll never forget what the Cordell family has done for me. I'll never forget when this church started. I'll never forget the day that I married my wife. I'll never forget the day that my son was born, that my daughter was born. I'll never forget that stuff. Thank God that I get to consider the miracles that God has been doing in my life. Church today, what do you need to be considering? What miracles have been going on in your life that you can go back right now and think about and consider and use those considerations, use those thoughts, use those memories to soften your heart up again and get that encouragement that you need to get back out there, get back on the field and serve the Lord? Because if we don't, there's no hope. Jesus had compassion on those people, and he pushed his disciples to do that work. They had already done all this work. Jesus was just pushing them even more. And then after he pushed them to feed the 5,000, he pushed them to get on a boat and row overnight with the wind being contrary to them. Jesus knows the hard work that you're doing because this is what he's called you to do. But remember the miracles. He's given you the capability to do it. He's given you the compassion to do it. He's given you the capacity to do it. He's given you the calling to do it. And he's given you a place to communicate and to gather together and get ideas from each other and encourage each other. Jesus has done all of that for this church. So we need to take the time today. Let's consider the miracles that the Lord has done for us. And let's not let our hearts get hardened, because the service here is only going to get bigger. People are going to come. The church is going to grow. Another church is going to be started. You know, the pastor's goal before he dies is to start 20 churches in Philadelphia. How is that going to happen? It's a miracle. And so our job is to not get hardened, make sure we think about those miracles, and help him to reach the goal that God has called him to do. Let's think about those miracles tonight. Let's pray. Miss Candy will be here in a minute, but if you want, take some time right now and pray and just think about